Well, good evening. I will call the village board meeting to order. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Here.
Trustee Miller.
Present.
Trustee Addison.
Here.
Trustee Siddick.
Here.
Trustee Wells.
Here.
Attorney Farola.
Here.
Mayor Hooker.
I think I'm here.
Mayor Courtney Gallo is present.
All right. If you would all please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, our first order of business tonight is the approval of the village board regular meeting minutes of November 14th. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes as presented? There being none, do we have a motion to approve?
Second.
Motion by trustee Gus, second by trustee Miller. Any discussion on the minutes? All right, roll call please.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Motion carries. Next we have the approval of the warrants list. Bills presented for payment in the amount of $284,762.18. Do we have a motion to approve?
I'll give you that motion, Mayor.
Second.
Motion by trustee Jensen, second by trustee Miller. Any discussion on the list? Right, there being none. This is what happens when we don't have a meeting every 2 weeks. The bills get bigger. Roll call, please.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Motion carries. We have no special business on the agenda tonight. Now would be time for public comment on any items listed on the agenda. Would anyone care to address the board? There being none, that we shall move on then to mayor's report. I'm going to save what I have to say to later in the agenda. So trustee reports, first up we've got trustee Gus.
Thank you, Your Honor. The DB quarterly have their second edition. You gave people get a chance, just grab it. We got the 2 pages of our Stone Creek Park and a lot of information. Stop by for fun. A lot of good reading. And that's it for me.
Yeah. All right, sir. Next up, we have Trustee Jensen.
Thank you, Mayor. I have two items. Our annual PAFR, popular annual financial report for the year ending April 30th, is finally off the press and. It's available on our website, and it's easy reading. It's very graphically oriented, which for me is a boon because I don't like to read tabular stuff. So I highly recommend it. And I've just been informed that for lack of agenda items, we will not be having a December Finance Committee meeting. I'm sorry to disappoint everyone. That concludes my report.
Thank you, sir. All right, Trustee Miller.
Thank you, Your Honor. First of all, the Beach Park Complete Count Committee hosted a successful census job fair. It was on November 20th, and I just want to take an opportunity to thank the two recruiters from the U.S. Census Bureau who traveled out here from Schaumburg and Rockford to work with our constituents. I think we had about 10-ish people that showed up, and we were able to get them help with their applications, thanks to the Zion Benton Public Library, who loaned us 5 laptops. So the people that came here to apply were able to immediately go online and send in their application. Also want to thank the Lake County, Illinois News for promoting the event to their followers on Facebook, and the Lake County government for tweeting about our event. And everyone on the committee who assisted in promoting it, we're very grateful. Secondly, I just want to make mention of the fact that Beach Park is now designated as a Soul Smart Gold community. And as part of this designation, B Beach Park has made changes to our local processes, which means zoning and permitting processes. And these changes reduce the time it takes to install a solar energy system. And by reducing all that, those aspects, these actions, the solar companies can reduce their own costs for installation and pass those savings on to our consumers, our customers, who are their customers. And so Beach Park is now officially open for solar business. And if you take a look on your way out of the lobby upstairs, you'll see in the display case there is a nice new award on the top shelf, 2019 award for solar, for SolSmart Gold Community. And then last but not least, certainly I would like to call out the fact that the 2019 Lake County Municipal League Innovation Awards were held on December 4th, just last week. And Beach Park was one of five communities that submitted a project, and the Lake County Municipal League Awards program recognizes municipalities that develop strategic programs to solve municipal challenges and increase the effectiveness of local government. Everyone has before them a couple of copies of recognition letters that were received. The first one is from Honorable Brad Schneider. And just one of the things he mentioned was the fact that the Village of Beach Park earned an honorable mention at the awards dinner for our work with neighboring communities to create the Northern Lakeshore Trail Connectivity Plan project. And we've been talking about this for quite a few months now. The project has really moved along quite well. And Representative Schneider also said, "I proudly applaud these dedicated civil servants for their commendable efforts to serve our communities." And secondly, there's a letter of recognition from Senator Tammy Duckworth. And part of what she said was, "Congratulations on the Villages of Beach Park's Lake County Municipal League Innovation Award honorable mention." And she says, "I applaud your work to encourage inclusivity and transparency throughout the planning. I wish Beach Park and all the involved communities further success as this project progresses, and congratulations on the remarkable achievement." Now, our assistant village administrator, Lisa Namatka, was responsible for the submission primarily. Lisa, you want to give us a little bit more insight as to how everything could.
So the board is very aware of this plan, and what makes it an innovative award-winning plan is the regional effort. It is, as the mayor often says, we are greater as a body. And so with Winthrop Harbor, Zion, Beach Park, Waukegan, and North Chicago working together on this plan, that's what the award was for, was that kind of regional work and the work that's being done and the partnership and cooperation between the mayors and the elected officials. As far as the plan is concerned, we are currently just received from our engineering consultant the key recommendations, and so we're reviewing those on a staff level to get back to the engineer before the holidays, and then there'll be another public information meeting that'll happen after the first of the year, where those key recommendations will be a steering committee first, so that the steering committee can provide feedback, and then after that there'll be a public information group too. And I'll advise the board on all of these dates so that if you want to pop in and out and connect to the plan. But we are very proud to have been able to quarterback this on behalf of all five communities.
Thank you. And the mayor, you were there. You wanted to say a little bit?
Well, it's always a pleasure to show up at a municipal league dinner where there's, I don't know how many communities are represented there, 40, 50. And see our village's name listed as a potential award winner, and then to actually receive the honorable mention. I think this is the third or fourth time that we've submitted and been recognized through our efforts. So this particular plan is a kind of a mobility plan. It gives bicycle and pedestrian access starting all the way down at the north boundary of Lake Bluff, and to allow residents to travel as far north as the state line, and also to look at east-west connections to the McClory and Des Plaines River trails as well. So the goal is to for those that are either currently bicycling or walking, or those that wish they could, to give them a safe path to do that throughout the communities here. And I do want to strongly recognize the teamwork that goes into this, and credit John Kinseth's vision and Lisa's hard work on putting these people all in the same room and getting cooperation and making progress like that. So the plan is the first thing, and then the second element of this is funding it. And again, funding it as a group takes the burden off of any one community, but also, as we know, applying for grants and federal or state funding, when it's a regional approach, that scores a lot better than an individual community. So I think it's all good all the way through, and it's be exciting to see where it lands and what the next steps will be. So.
And the connectivity is more than just the path. It's the connectivity between the communities.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So this is the, this isn't a Christmas present for me. I thought it was at first. Here's the award. This is what the village was presented with, and I'm sure it'll be in a display case upstairs somewhere prominently so that people can take a look at it. And that's all I have. Thank
Very
you.
Very good. Thank you. Trustee Adderson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to bring up a very unpopular subject with a lot of us this time of year, but if we ignore what happened on Halloween, because that didn't really happen, it was a bizarre occurrence. It is wintertime, and we have snow that will probably be coming soon. Just a reminder to everyone, if it's going to snow, don't put your car on the road. We don't like towing cars, but we're good at it, right? Is that what you say, Jerry? We're good at it. So, and also, if you have a fire hydrant in front of your house, it's good for you and your neighbors alike. If you keep it clear so the firemen don't have to dig to it while your house is burning. So, potentially
burning. Yes.
Hopefully not. But, and that was all I had to mention. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, it's the time of the year where Public Works really shines for us. So, although I did talk to a couple of the Public Works members today or yesterday and said, you know, if it could just snow during business hours, you know, instead of at 3 a.m. when, you know, guys are normally sleeping, that would be the best. But we'll see how it goes.
Well, make some calls, see what you can do.
Okay.
You're a powerful man.
Yeah, right. I thought you were in charge of that. Okay.
All right.
Trustee Siddick.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just have one item. This Tuesday, the 17th, at 1 p.m., we'll be having a public safety committee meeting, and the discussion will be the contract with the Lake County Sheriff's Department. So 17th at 1 o'clock for anybody who would like to come.
Okay. Making progress there, too.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Trustee Wells.
Thank you, Your Honor. I have a couple of pieces of information to share with the public. Number one, contractors and residents can apply for permits and request an inspection 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, right on the village's website at www.villageofbeachpark.com. And secondly, the next building planning zoning committee meeting is scheduled for January 23rd, 2020 at 6 o'clock p.m. in the Village Hall. That concludes my report.
Thank you very much. All right. I think you all received a copy of the administrator's report. Jerry, is there anything you wanted to add tonight? No? Okay. Thank you. Next, we have our consent agenda. The following items will be considered. The finance report, which is included in your packet. Public safety report. Resolution 34, which will be a resolution establishing regular meeting dates for the village board and committees of the Village of Beach Park. And Resolution 35, which is a resolution establishing the holiday schedule for the 2020 calendar year in the Village of Beach Park. As I say, all those are included in your packet. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Motion second. By Trustee Gust, second by Trustee Siddick. Discussion? All right. I like this format a whole lot better, I might say. I don't know if Mary Jo remembers having like five different ordinances for five different groups of meetings. This is so much nicer.
Yes.
This is great. All right, any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Johnson.
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay, on to the excitement of ordinances and resolutions. First up, we've got one, Trustee Addison, what have you got for us?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The first item is an agreement between us and the Solid Waste Agency of Lake County, otherwise known as SWALCO. They're expanding their recycling program for clothing and textiles. A meeting last month, we went over their proposal and agreed that it should come to the board for a vote. They requested that we have a recycling site at the Public Works facility that people can come and drop off clothing and textiles to be recycled. The bin will be inside the fence, similar to our electronics recycling dumpster, so it's accessible during working hours only, which I see as a good thing because there has been other sites that are always available that people have a tendency to come and drop a truckload of stuff on the ground all around it, and then it blows everywhere over the weekend or whatever. So it will be during working hours during the week. I assume we will, in short order, put something on our website that has the extensive list of accepted items and not accepted items. I won't go through that tonight because we want to go home before the end of the meeting. But so I'll put that in the form of an ordinance to authorize an execution of an intergovernmental agreement between Beach Park and SWALCO regarding the village hosting and maintaining a clothing and textiles recycling site.
Second.
A motion by Trustee Addison, a second by Trustee Miller. This would be ordinance 45. Any discussion? Yeah, I'm sure there will be some graphics on there as to that. Yeah.
I don't remember if there's anything in the proposal about them providing a sign, but I'm sure we could come up with something. Was there something included or? Okay. By the time they get to the bin, though, it's too late. So maybe we'll need to put one out on the fence so they can read it before they go home and load their car.
Yeah.
And then come back.
Don't bring your mattress.
Right.
All right. Roll call, please.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Johnson.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Motion carries. The next three items will be presented by Jerry, and I guess we'll start you off with item B. Is your mic on? I'm sorry. Okay. She can't hear you. Sorry.
Start over.
No.
Can you hear me now? Okay, so the first two ordinances have to do with the cannabis regulations in the municipal code. One is for the opt-out that we're directed to take care of or draft for the board for tonight's meeting. And also the other one, the other ordinance takes care of other regulations in the municipal code dealing with the cannabis. So we can get all of the whole municipal code cleaned up in one meeting here. And then the resolution that the third part of this is sections of the employee handbook to make sure that we update our employee regulations with respect to the new cannabis laws that are coming down starting January 1st. So the first ordinance on the agenda is the ordinance prohibiting the cannabis business establishments in the Village of Beach Park. And if you refer to the cover memo, that the cannabis businesses that we have defined are cannabis craft grower, cannabis cultivation center, cannabis dispensing organization, cannabis infuser organization or infuser, whoever you want to look at, cannabis lounge or social space, cannabis processing organization or processor, cannabis transporting organization or transporter.
Okay, so I was going to say, we have the ordinance would be number 46. Do we have a motion to approve?
I would be happy to make that motion.
Motion by Trustee Addison. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Trustee Miller. Discussion. All right, we have no discussion.
Yeah, we've had our say on
that. Yep, that's fine. All right, roll call, please.
Trustee Siddig.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gust.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
No.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Motion carries.
And just for the board's information, Jerry and I will be following up with changes to the zoning code that track these changes, which are found in the business regulations and licensing code. That'll probably come. The zoning meeting will be in February.
We'll bring it up at the February meeting.
And that'll come to you probably in the second meeting in February.
Okay.
But this is your opt-out that tells the world that they can't set the businesses up here.
All right. All right, so then the next one?
Yeah, the second ordinance is cleaning up the other sections of the municipal code related to cannabis. And in the cover sheet for the ordinance that the staff wrote, it lists all of the different sections here so that it accurately reflects what we're just doing and accurately reflects the upcoming state law January 1st.
All
I
right.
can read each of those sections if you want, but I don't think you want to listen to all of that.
Suffice to say, it is cleaning up multiple sections. So
yes, it is.
Okay. All right. This would be Ordinance 47. Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
We got a Trustee Addison and Trustee Gust. Would I call that a second? All right.
Sound like a tie.
Any discussion? All right. Roll call, please.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gust.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddig.
Aye.
Motion carries. All right.
Okay, and the last one is just cleaning up the handbook to reflect the new state law regarding cannabis so that we make sure that we have everything incorporated so our employees are well aware of that. What we're going to do upon passage of this, that we're going to have meetings. Lisa's going to have meetings with each of the, we'll have a meeting at the Village Hall, one at Public Works, so that she can accurately explain what's in the revisions to the handbook. Everybody they'll hear it from us, they'll get a written copy of it, they'll sign for it, so everybody will be duly informed of what's in there. We did make two other, I think there was a little minor, there's a typo in the handbook that we corrected, I believe it's outlined, and then we used to have, in the handbook it always had Good Friday that we had as a holiday, and we changed that to President's Day, so that's also been corrected.
Okay, very good. All right, so this would be a resolution, Resolution 36, adopting the amendments to the Village Beach Park Employee Handbook. Do we have a motion to approve?
Second.
Motion by Trustee Gust and second by Trustee Miller. Discussion?
I have one technical question.
Sure.
That perhaps can't be answered tonight. We referenced testing in several places, and on page, for instance, on page 70, mid third paragraph down, we're talking about testing positive. But there's no reference to any kind of standards or values. What's considered positive now that recreational marijuana is going to be available broadly? It's conceivable that one could be exposed to secondhand smoke, for instance. I don't know the biology of this, if one would test positive. CBD oil, I understand, also can contain a certain amount of THC, which is currently available and very popular, I guess. So I'm just curious as to, are we going to reference some national standards or IDOT standards or some other standards?
Those are very good questions, and what we do recommend, if we do require testing, if we have a reasonable suspicion, you suspect somebody is under the influence while working, for example, or you're testing a CDL driver, we do recommend that we employ sophisticated blood testing rather than urine testing. Blood testing is more accurate, is what the literature is saying. Five nanograms of THC in the bloodstream is pretty good evidence that someone is currently under the influence. With urine testing, you may pick up traces of THC that shows that someone's not necessarily under the influence, but used several weeks ago. So we do recommend that blood testing is used. I don't think those standards need to be incorporated here in your policy. I think ultimately you would take an employee, and we do recommend that we take employees to testing centers.
Yep.
And have testing professionally administered. So it's going to evolve. It's certainly going to evolve, and it's going to be based on really the medical that's out there and the different testing procedures that are developing. But it's a great question because...
Yeah, I'm anxious about establishing a policy with no parameters. It's like having a speed limit with no numbers.
There are parameters, though. I mean,
But we don't address that.
But we also don't address them for alcohol testing. There are established standards that we use for corporate health.
Absolutely. No, I think IDOT or USDOT.
Certainly,
does.
Certainly. And they will for these ultimately, but this is a brave new world in Illinois.
Indeed, yeah. And this is a question that...
Yep.
That just popped up in my mind as I read this.
Every employer in the state is asking that.
I'd want to have some idea that I'm not at risk for losing my job because my friend smoked in my car.
Right. There's zero case law at this point under the state statutes. The corporate health center that we use for all of our employee testing and drug testing and all of that will ultimately have recommendations that will follow, just as we do for our alcohol pre-employment and post-accident and suspicion and all those other things. So some of this is yet to be ironed out as to the facts.
Well, nobody wants to be the test case. So.
Well, no, but we can't ignore this.
No, I'm not advocating
that.
So I'm advocating going
first
a step beyond what
right.
we've done here.
But it would be irresponsible for us to establish standards that are yet to be proven. And that's
there
also...
There are no established... Other states certainly have precedent.
Certainly, but this is, as I say, from employment law in Illinois, this is brand new as far
I understand, but in terms of USDOT,
right.
Railroad, airlines, some there's got to be standards that we could certainly reference.
The 5-nanogram standard is pretty regularly used, and that's a blood test. Now, a couple of things that may make you more comfortable. The state law, the Cannabis Act, requires if somebody does test positive that they get a chance to appeal.
Yeah, I saw that split sample language, right?
There's a process in that regard, but it's today, even before the law goes into effect, if somebody gets pulled over on the side of the road and is slurring their speech, but not necessarily under the influence of alcohol, but acting in a manner where they seem impaired, and they do go submit to a urine test, and THC shows up, there's a presumption that can be argued that someone is under the influence based on their behavior. So there's articulable suspicion, there's the appeal right. I think what we are recommending is we do take employees to professional testing centers for sophisticated blood work that would probably give us the best evidence.
I appreciate that, and I'm familiar with the reasonable suspicion approach, and because you've got prescription drugs, you've got all sorts of things that can influence one's behavior. And I get that, and that's likely to, if that's what gets them into testing, you're likely to find high numbers, and that won't be disputable. It's more the CDL kind of approach where it's just a broad net,
right.
and there are no symptoms that drive that test. It's just a random number that comes up.
And it's even more important with the trailer bill that just passed, mm-hmm. relative to public safety employees, firemen and policemen cannot use cannabis either on or off duty at any time. And you know, you don't have those types of employees. They are subject to random testing, like CDL drivers. So it's gonna be a challenge. I think it's gonna evolve. This policy is a pretty much right down the middle. This is a policy that we're seeing, that we've had many, many clients adopt to move forward, at least get us into next year.
Right.
Go from there.
The other dimensions, and when you talk about law enforcement, is the reality of the traffic stops and the like. there are devices being worked on now that claim to be able to use a breathalyzer-type approach for THC, but those products that aren't on the market yet, those may become available testing method down the road as well. But yeah, we count heavily on our professionals over at the Corporate Health Center that we use as far as recommended testing and the like. We have DOT standards that we have to comply with already for the physical, and I'm sure we'll end up, if we do random testing, we'll end up using those standards because those apply to most of the drivers and the like. So yeah, I understand your concern. I just don't think we have the answer to be able to write it into our
As I said, I don't expect it to be answered tonight, but I think it's something that needs to be addressed.
Sure, certainly, yeah. Whether
Thank
it be
you.
In the procedure or in a policy, one or the other, yeah. Okay, we have any other discussion on this? All right, roll call, please.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Motion carries. Moving on then, we have Trustee Addison again.
Thanks again, Mr. Mayor. Excuse me. You touched on something earlier when we were discussing the connectivity plan. This resolution is related to that. It's something that we have learned about through the Municipal League and other areas for a program called a Complete Streets Program. What it does, let's see, one description. So Village of Beach Park residents should be able to drive, walk, or bike safely and conveniently throughout the Village of Beach Park on a day, for daily needs and activities. What this does is it doesn't necessarily tie our hands to a standard, but it does mean that we are going to consider when we look at any roadway right-of-way infrastructure programs, we will consider adding sensible pedestrian and bike lanes along with that. One of the main reasons that a lot of the communities in the state are doing this now, it does give us a more favorable score when it comes to applying for grants for roadway and infrastructure projects. We have talked about this a couple times at the committee meeting. There was some language that was maybe a little stronger we were comfortable with. We did make adjustments within the rules. You know, it was kind of a boilerplate thing, but we, you know, you are allowed to adjust it locally. So there were a couple tweaks that were made. Don spent a lot of time working on that. And so at the last month's meeting, we recommended passing it on to the board. So this is in the form of a resolution to adopt the Complete Streets policy for the Village of Beach Park.
Well, we have a motion by Trustee Addison. Do we have
second.
A second? A second by Trustee Jensen. Discussion.
I'd just like to echo what Mark said. The original model language was very, there's a lot of shalls and musts in there, and without regard for the unique character of a lot of our streets that are quite narrow, there's no room for bike paths and walking paths and sidewalks and all that. And so we did modify with help of staff and support to permissible language where feasible, and it makes a lot more sense for us. And it's not that we don't want to do it, but there are places where that original language just did not apply.
Right. We do have some narrow right-of-ways that just would be almost impossible.
Well, there's some cases on a small project that doesn't make a lot of sense to put in a sidewalk that doesn't connect to anything else.
Right.
You know, so we in the past have, you know, when it's a developer, like in the subdivision ordinance, when it calls for something like that, we would make an exception and take money in lieu of the sidewalk and then group that together for a bigger project in the area at a later date or in another area or something like that. So, like I said, it's just something that gets us a more favorable score by having this in place. And it does kind of, I think it was intended to make you stop and think before you finalize your design. Hey, are we addressing the needs of the walkers as opposed to just the drivers? So.
Well, it seems to be a lot more attention paid nowadays when communities are repaving and restructuring their developments as to the pedestrian and how's the pedestrian going to get through here, not just the cars.
Right.
And we've had way too many just critical events happen here in our own village that were tragic.
Yep.
So we know how important that is. And, you know, in the bigger picture, this another good reason to do this.
All right, any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next item, actually the next two items, if you don't read carefully, it could be a little confusing. There are two separate resolutions related to purchasing salt for the snow melting season. The first one is through the State of Illinois Joint Purchasing Program. I'll back up a little bit. The reason for having two is if one source dries up, we've got another source under contract where we can purchase the road salt. I think we have just about a barn full left over from last year too, because we never got all the terrible snow that we were supposed to. But we need to be under contract and prepared to purchase the salt. So this one is resolution authorizing the purchase of up to 1,080 tons of rock salt at the price of $81.15 per ton from Compass Minerals American Inc., Overland, Kansas, for the 1920 winter season through the State of Illinois Joint Purchasing Contract. And that was a motion to approve a resolution, sir.
All right, there we have a motion by Trustee Addison, second by Trustee Gus. This is a resolution number 38. Any discussion? All right, roll call please.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Motion carries.
All right, and the next resolution will sound a lot like the last one, but there are some slight differences, including the price. This will be, I'm proposing that we approve a motion, or a resolution authorizing purchase of up to 720 tons of rock salt at the price of $63.72 per ton from Morton Salt, Inc. in Chicago for the 1920 winter season. And this is through the Lake County Cooperative Purchasing Program.
All right, we have a motion from Trustee Addison. Second by Trustee Gus. That is resolution 39. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
All right. Item H, Trustee Wells.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want an item for your consideration, and that involves a resolution approving an access easement agreement with Casey's Retail Company. Some background on that, Casey's Retail Company has proposed and submitted a retail development at the southeast corner of Wadsworth and Sheridan Road. This development has been through all the village entitlement processes and received approval of the same. Part of the project involved relocation of Paxton Drive from an access point on Sheridan Road to an access point on Wadsworth Road. The old Paxton Drive had been provided to Casey's Retail Company as part of development in exchange for the relocated Paxton Drive. There's one property that is affected by the relocation, and that is property owned by the village. In order to access the property, the village had requested an easement agreement with Casey's Retail Company. Also, IDOT is requesting a copy of the signed easement agreement for their permit. And on the easement agreement is asking for a date the plat was recorded. Plat cannot be filed and recorded until IDOT signs off on it. It's kind of a catch-22 for us and Casey's. In order to keep the project moving forward, staff is acting for the easement agreement approval, and staff will fill in the required recording date when the when that takes place. The village attorney was consulted about this, and he is fine with this proceeding in this direction at this time. And I'd like to entertain in the form of a motion.
And we have a motion by Trustee Wells.
Second.
We have a second by Trustee Siddick. This is resolution number 40. And any discussion? All right, roll call please.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
That concludes my report, Your Honor.
Thank you. Motion carries. On to new business. Item A. Trustee Addison, you seem to have a lot of, you must have really auditioned well for the part tonight, because you've got a lot of lines.
Thank you. although I am told I have a face for radio. here we are. This item is authorizing approval of an addendum to our consulting services agreement for the 2020 MFT street maintenance project with our village engineers, RHMG. the amount not to exceed $112,400. What this is we had already identified the streets and the lengths, the areas we're gonna do for our program. We have had good luck last year and the year before with getting our programs out on the streets early, getting favorable bids. We have committed, as a board, to spending, a large amount of money on our road resurfacing project every year to try and keep up with, the demand and the need for, road, rehabilitation. So in an effort to get ahead of this, if the, money is there, if the bids come in favorably, we would like to add, an alternate to the bids when we go out for this. And we've identified, three additional areas that we would like to pave if the money goes far enough. We don't want to be in a position where the bids came in pretty low and we've got a bunch of money left over and we're not spending what we're committed to spend. So we would like to have our engineers, prepare the design and have this ready to go out to bid with, the whole package as an alternate and hopefully be able to do these additional streets. So like I said, this, this just raises our agreement with them for, design, testing, soil boring and, construction-related services during the project to add these streets if that, comes to be. So I would make in the form of a motion to authorize the agreement, for the addendum with our HMG for the additional engineering.
We have a motion.
I'll second that.
By trustee Addison, second by trustee Jensen. Discussion.
And this is also to make sure that these three options are not cost prohibitive.
Correct.
Yes.
If we were to do them separately, they would cost more money. So you have the economy of scale by doing it all together. That's a good point, too.
Mayor, can I just add something to that?
Certainly.
It's not only paving it. Two of these are extensions of roadways. They're dead ends. So the Garnett, Garnett Avenue extension goes from Paddock to, Garnett goes from Paddock to, Fairstyle?
It says here Maumin on our.
Maumin. Goes from Maumin. But there are two extensions and then also the alley on the east side of Sheridan Road.
Yeah.
That, you know, the only alley we have on the east side of Sheridan Road there is to redo that also. And, most of the paving work that's being done, the MFT work that is being done in that corridor down there. So it makes sense to do this work down there.
It shouldn't add a lot of re-mobilization costs because they're in the area.
And each of them are being, they're being bid out separately, so each one of it is at a separate addendum. So if, obviously, if we have money to do one, we'll do one. If we have money to do three, we'll do three. But they're being bid out separately so that we can make that determination.
And the design will be complete.
Yep.
If we don't have the money, we can do them next time. The design should still be the same.
It's not wasted, correct?
No.
And I think it's important that we're trying to get some of these dead ends, these discontinuous roads corrected where we've got issues with snowplows, with public safety access,
Garbage trucks.
Garbage trucks, yeah.
Exactly. So by making those three streets where they should have been, they just never got finished through.
Yep.
Is gonna be a benefit, I think, all around.
Drop in the bucket.
Yep.
Yeah, gotta start somewhere.
All right, any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Jensen.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Motion carries. All right, now is the opportunity for any citizen that would wish to address the board on any or all topics. Don't all get up and talk at once. Paul, are you awake? Oh.
He's texting, I think.
I'm just checking. Sorry.
We just volunteered you to be the head of the party planning committee. You're okay with that, right?
Yeah.
Just say yes and we'll move on.
Well, I'll take that as a nobody wants to talk. We do have cause tonight for an executive session under Section 2C1 of the Illinois Open Meetings Act. The appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employee of the public body or legal counsel for the public body. We will be adjourning to executive session. We will be returning for potential action after. So we need a motion to adjourn to executive session.
I'll second that.
We have a trustee Gust and trustee Trustee Johnson, you got that under control.
Yeah.
Okay. any discussion on this topic before we go? All right, roll call, please.
Trustee Gus.
Aye.
Trustee Johnson.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Trustee Addison.
Aye.
Trustee Siddick.
Aye.
Trustee Wells.
Aye.
I think we'll just go.